I just want to ask a couple of questions. They're not related in any way to each other. First, what is the number one stereotype that Christians misapply to atheists? And then two, and I don't know genetically modified skeptics' background, but what would it take for you, Dan, to go back to Christianity? And if genetically modified skeptic falls into kind of your same category, the question would remain the same for him.
Okay. First of all, I should say I know Dean. We've had conversations. Dean, you are a pastor at a church in, I don't know where, actually.
North Carolina.
We have a lot of pastors and people that come on the show that we talk to, apparently. It's really great. Dean and I have talked before. He's a good guy, as far as I know. So, your first question was, what is the most common thing? I think, what Christians get wrong is, number one, definitely by far, every single time, the definition of atheism, or at least how most atheists in the community at large understand atheism. And I'm putting that out there first because I had it wrong, super wrong. And there's a video of me out there giving a definition of atheism on Anthony Magnamoscu's channel that's just completely wrong and just not what the community uses. So if I was to change one thing about the Christian mind right now, if all the Christians in the world, I would adjust their definition of atheism that matches closer to what's actually in use amongst atheists, because I think there's a grave misunderstanding with how we use the term a lack of belief, or the difference between knowing that there are no gods and not having a belief that there are any gods is huge, and it's very subtle, but it's a huge, huge thing, and it makes it a huge difference when we're talking about our beliefs. And your second question was, what would it take for me to become a Christian? So I think that if we're talking about the traditional, you know, because Christianity has a lot of different definitions, depending on who you talk to, and that means a lot of different things to different people. I think at base, if we're talking about the base value of Christianity, like the mere Christianity, I would have to be at least convinced that there was a man named Jesus Christ 2,000 years ago who did, in fact, die and rise again for the sins of humanity. And already there's like five different terms there that could be defined in different ways in different Christian communities on what that actually means. But if we could just talk about it as a historical fact, whether this event actually happened or not, or whether I have reason to believe that this event actually happened, I think that would be a start as far as Christianity. But that doesn't even answer the God question at all. Those could be two different things. And we kind of see it as the same thing because as Christians, you're taught to believe Jesus as God. But I don't – that could happen. Jesus could do all that, and God could be a completely different thing or might not even be a thing at all. Because epistemically, they're kind of two different questions. So Christianity in particular being the Christian claims of Jesus, I think that is my kind of starting point. Drew, what do you think?
Two big questions. As far as what Christians get wrong, it's not just Christians. It's really anybody. Actually, other atheists do this to atheists too, and statistics in the United States even show that atheists often distrust, or people who just say, "Oh, you know, like I don't really believe in God, or I'm not religious," tend to distrust atheists, and almost see them as less human in a lot of ways, just like you know a theist might. But yeah, the biggest thing that people get wrong who aren't atheists, and sometimes they are even, is they dehumanize atheists by oversimplifying what they are and who they are, in the way that one of the things that people say is, you're an atheist. You don't believe in anything then, or you think that we came from nothing, or, you know, you think this, you think that, or you just, you know, got your feelings hurt by the church. And so you left. And it's always, you just are this, you just are that. well, no, I'm not just one thing or another. I'm just as human as you. That's the only just that's justified there. I'm just as human as you. I'm just as complex as you. My reasoning is just as nuanced and hard to understand and complex, you know, as anyone else's. And so if I hate it when Christ or when atheists say, oh, you're just a Christian because you were raised that way. Well, yeah, that might be a big reason or something, but that's not everything there. And if you insist that that's the only reason why any religious person is religious, then you're dehumanizing them by oversimplifying their entire being. Yeah. And I just think it's just absolutely ridiculous to do that. So I won't do that to you. And I think that, you know, it's not fair of me to do that to you for being a pastor. I'm not going to say, oh, you just are Christian because of this. And I just ask that you do the same. And, you know, if you're kind of a friend of Dan's and you're calling in and asking, I feel like I can probably safely assume that you're a person who really tries not to oversimplify what atheists think, because it sounds like you're actually curious about it. So kudos to you. I want atheists to reciprocate.
Well, yeah. No, I agree with you there. I think the thing that bothers me the most, and this is just in culture in general, is that there is a lot of oversimplification towards people that we might disagree with. And I think to a large extent, not just politically, but even in the big divide between, you know, people who lack a belief in God and those who affirm a belief in God, you know, the oversimplification, I think, is driven from a point of, or can be driven from a point of what you've talked about as far as dehumanizing the other side. And one of the things that I think is beneficial, I think that both sides have to do a better job of, is not going for the for the red meat, I guess you could say, towards specific audiences. I'm not saying that you guys do that. I've told Dan multiple times I love y'all's show. But personalities, both in the atheistic community and certainly in the Christian community, oftentimes the reason why they do oversimplify that is so that they can get red meat to their subscribing audience, and their subscribing audience can just be an echo chamber to affirm how awesome their representative is. And I don't think that gets anybody anywhere, because I think whether you believe in God or you don't believe in God, the question of God's existence, you know, is Christianity true? You know, I think that those are really, and I think you would agree with me that those are monumental questions, that simply to oversimplify those for the sake of, building up a subscriber base is pretty bad. And I'd like to see the conversation move more towards, okay, well, what are the, you know, what's the genuine case for the lack of belief, and what's the genuine case for the belief that Christianity is true? And I think if we get there I think if we get to that point without the oversimplification and without the dehumanizing, I think that that's, like you've talked about, you know, multiple times in your show, that's where you can really have a substantive discussion and truth can genuinely be found. So,
yeah, no, I totally agree. And this is not a partisan idea, right? This isn't like an atheist idea. This isn't a Christian idea. I think this is just hopefully it's not tooting my own horn or anyone else's here. I don't know if we could actually, you know, put that on a show, me tooting Dan's horn, but,
not on public television.
That would have to stream on my channel, right?
Yeah.
But no, I think that it's just a bit,
I think there are laws against that. Sorry, go on.
It's just a bit more of a nuanced or hopefully mature idea that we shouldn't oversimplify and we shouldn't just straw man, you know. Yeah, a lot of the time people make like response videos and stuff in my sphere, and it's low-hanging fruit, and like sometimes it's just for entertainment, it's just funny, whatever. But sometimes people think that those are the actual issues, like that's it, that's all there is. I mean, this crazy person with a cell phone made a video, and then, you know, this atheist YouTuber responded to it, and that disproved all of Christianity. Now, there are some atheists out there who think that. Nobody in my circle that I know of really actually thinks that. A lot of the time it's just, you're just playing around with jokes there. But yeah, no, I think that we have common ground there, and it's not an atheist or a Christian issue to want to strive toward that. Now, to answer the second question, if I can here, Dan hit on the actual Christ part of it, which I think is an important aspect. Now, if I'm going to define Christianity as being more reliant on like Christian metaphysics as a metaphysical perspective, like, you know, the supernatural actually exists, and that God, the nature of God is such, as far as talking about maybe his like supernatural qualities. For me, I think we would first have to have some kind of reliable way of determining what the supernatural is and isn't. We'd have to be able to somehow observe or measure the supernatural directly. Now, whether or not that actually makes it definitionally natural is kind of another question. But we'd have to have some way to reliably look into what the supernatural is. And from there, I would need to have evidence that God's nature, like we need to directly observe that God's nature is this non-contradictory amalgamation of all of the omnis there, you know, omnipresent, or omniscient, omnipotent, everything. It would need to be able to be observed and not just logically play out. It needs to, or put in like a syllogism that actually, you know, makes sense. I feel like there needs to be evidence there. It needs to be observed and observable. And then as far as if you're talking about the Bible, if you want to get as material as actually talking about the Bible itself, I would need the Bible to be the one and only holy text which people or just scripture that no one disagrees about. Everyone fundamentally knows what the actual one truth of the Bible is, and that would demonstrate that and like that the message has always been unchanging. There hasn't been all this division about it among people who have really fundamentally been trying as hard as they possibly can. And then at that point, it would demonstrate that God actually created something which is it just massively, infinitely superior to any literary work that man has ever produced. If it can't be demonstrated to be something that's massively just more comprehensible and complex than anything that man has ever produced, I don't know why I should think that it's anything but natural in origin. And so I do think it's natural in origin. I think if there's any flaw or any division over what it means, it basically ends up showing that God is a flawed author who can't get across his points, even to people who care about this question, you know, as much as they possibly could. Like, I think of myself as being one of those people, and I'm sure that you're one of those people as well, that really cares about this issue. So I think that Christianity being true would make it to where people like us would never even be able to disagree, and yet we would still have free will. And I think that a supernatural power could make that happen, but I don't think that there is a supernatural power behind it because it hasn't happened.
Ooh, ooh, ooh. Hey, Drew, I want to give a counterpoint right now to you, something you just said.
Okay.
Because I actually disagree with you a little bit, because I think your fundamentalist Baptist Christianity is showing a little bit, because your idea of Christianity being true has to rely on the Bible being God's word, is what it kind of sounds like. And I think you can conceive of a Christianity in which the Bible is not necessarily God's word, or even not directly written by God, or even directly inspired by God. And you could imagine a conception of Christianity being true. And I think that does happen.
Yeah, I think that's valid criticism.
I'll jump in because you know, I think, you know, Dan, this is going to sound weird, but Dan kind of beat me to the punch on that. You know, even if I weren't, and this is going to get into some questions about the Bible, but couldn't you make the case for, and this is just hypothetical, couldn't you make the case for Christianity being true even if, and this is going to sound weird, couldn't you make the case for the Bible being true even if you couldn't demonstrate that it was divinely inspired?
Okay, well, let's define something here. What do you mean by the Bible being true?
So maybe a better definition would be historically, reliable that, you know, the things that are in the Bible say, I mean, like you talked about, like the resurrection is probably the most common one that's talked about. Say, even if that specific section and account can't be shown empirically to be divinely inspired, you could still show that it was an actual historical event. And therefore, the premise of Jesus being divine or the resurrection taking place is true. Does that make sense?
I think so. Let me try to repeat. You're saying even if the Bible wasn't divinely inspired and that we could prove that the Bible was historically accurate in its claims of Jesus' resurrection, we could demonstrate Christianity to be true? Is that right?
Yeah, so I'm saying, you know, so Drew, and I don't want to miscategorize what Drew said, but, you know, he said you'd have to show that it was, and correct me at any point where I'm wrong, Drew, it seems like you're saying that in order for the Bible to be, or for Christianity to be true, you have to show that the book itself was inspired by God or influenced by God. But what I'm saying is, even if you took it just from a humanistic standpoint, in the same way that you would do historical investigations about certain historical events related to Rome or Italy or anything, or, well, Italy is part of Rome, but ancient Rome, ancient Babylon, if you took those historical measures and you put it towards something like the resurrection, couldn't, if it were possible to use those methods and show that that was true, wouldn't that make a certain tenet of Christianity true, even if you couldn't show that it was divinely inspired?
Yeah, in the way that I think that the narrative of the historical narrative of Christianity would then potentially be true if that was able to be evidenced. And you know, I'm not saying either way that it is or isn't here, but yeah. Ultimately, though, I don't think that, I don't know that you're actually saying this, I don't think that the historically being true is necessarily going to give any kind of validity, hand any validity to Christian metaphysics.
No, I see what you're saying there. I think Christian metaphysics and the historical reliability of the Bible are two different subjects there. I see what you're saying there. I was just giving a little bit of cordial pushback to the idea that we would have to show that the Bible is inspired by God empirically to demonstrate that it's, that the accounts were true. Does that make sense? And if I mischaracterized your argument, then let me know.
Yeah, no, I get what you're saying there.
Okay. But hey, thanks for calling. My family just walked in from a trunk or treat down at the church. So I got to go put my girls down, but appreciate you guys and appreciate the show. Thanks a lot.
Yeah, absolutely, hey. Dean. Thanks for calling.
Yeah, thanks for the call. And right. I think that, yeah, you've represented Christians and Christianity well. You know, keep doing it.
Thanks, man.
There you go.
Appreciate it. Take
care. Oh, all right. Yeah, that's Dean for you.
Yeah, seems like a cool guy. I really appreciate that discussion, and I hope that he calls back.
Yes, so it's interesting if we're talking about establishing, because when we're talking about historical events, we're dealing with probabilities in some way. I think we have to see what's most probable because we can't know exactly all the information that happens in a historical event, and we use narratives as a device to kind of explain the general happenstance, but in truth, it's the way that humans function in history is so complex and so many decisions are happening and so many actions are happening that it's impossible to simply describe on an individual level. So we do create these kinds of narratives. And I like how you pointed out about this, the Christian narrative, because there is a Christian narrative about the events and how they took place and what took place and who were the actors in those scenarios and stuff. And there's a lot of individual levels that I would wonder, okay, if we took this out and changed that, would that make Christianity more or less true? Like, what does the ramifications of that, or what does it even mean to say that Christianity is true when it comes to that? So it's a fascinating discussion that definitely we could talk about more in the future.